Hello students, now we are going to start the new chapter, that is ammonia. Ammonia having the formula NH3. Over there, nitrogen can easily share its 3 electron with hydrogen to make a covalent bond, and the molecular mass is 17 amu. 14 for nitrogen and 3 for this 3 hydrogen. Now, ammonia cannot be easily available in a major quantity in nature. So freely, in a free state, ammonia is present in a very small quantity in air and in water. But in combined state, it can be available in the form of ammonium chloride, ammonium nitrate, ammonium sulfate, ammonium phosphate and many other. Now one due reason question is there that ammonia and ammonium compounds, okay, they do not occur as a mineral. You know, in this, the major reason is this: all compounds are highly soluble in water. That's why they all are highly soluble in water. That's why it is not possible to collect ammonia on water, and they cannot occur as a mineral. Now, this ammonia is having a pungent, choking smell. And if you really want to experience that smell, then we have a better example, that is a public toilet, actually. You know why? Because in public toilet, we are thinking we are going to release a urine. But that urine contains a compound, that is urea. This is the formula of urea. Now this urea, in presence of the moisture, it is decomposed by bacteria. Yeah, this is a decomposition of urea by bacteria. And it releases ammonia plus water plus carbon dioxide. Now here this ammonia is released, which is actually having a pungent, choking smell. That's why the major thing when you are going to the public toilet, that very peculiar smell is there, that is because of ammonia only. Moving towards the forms of ammonia, we have ammonia in a gaseous form, ammonia in a liquefied form. Yeah, the same gas we can liquefy it by providing a high pressure, and that is called as liquid ammonia. Third and very important category is the liquor ammonia fortis. Liquor ammonia fortis is also called as 880 ammonia. You know why? Because this liquor ammonia fortis means we have to make saturated solution of ammonia in water. Yeah, this ammonia will be dissolved in water. As it is highly soluble in water, we have to make a saturated solution of ammonia in water, and at that time its relative density will be 0.880. yeah, the density will be 0.880 of that ammonia. That's why it is termed as 880 ammonia also. So this is liquor ammonia fortis. Yeah, now the last one is NH4OH. Yeah, we have to use this NH4OH in one of the chapter, like chapter 4, analytical chemistry is there. Over there we are using it for identification of some unknown components. Yeah, that I'll tell you later on. This is ammonium hydroxide. Moving to the next part is the laboratory preparation of ammonia. Here you can see the setup over there. We are actually going to use a round bottom flask, but we have make it tilted. Why it is so, that I'll tell you. Here the collecting unit is there. Here we are going to use a specific drying agent, and ammonia will be collected here. Now in the ammonia preparation, what we want actually, so we are going to use two chemical. One is NH4Cl, or you can use any ammonium compound, and second we are using alkali. I'm going to use CaOH twice. Yeah, this two mixture I kept here in this setup. In this setup, the mixture of NH4Cl and CaOH twice is kept. Now, the proportion I kept 2:3. What could be the reason for that? You know, ammonium chloride is one of the sublimating agent. So, higher ratio by weight of the alkali may counter react the loss of sublimation of NH4Cl. That means if I am going to use CaOH twice in more quantity, then the loss of NH4Cl can be easily counterbalanced, or it is counter react. So to have a balancing, we are taking the alkali content more and NH4Cl content little bit less by weight. Now in the setup, I'm going to provide a temperature from the bottom. Both the components are getting mixed over here, and when NH4Cl and CaOH twice get mixed, definitely the product form is calcium chloride plus water plus ammonia. Yeah, this is the reaction. Here we got ammonia. Now after formation of this ammonia, that ammonia will be passed through the delivery tube. Yeah, through this delivery tube, the ammonia get passed into the another chamber. And whatever water is remain, it will be remain in this area only. Now in this area, that water is remain in this particular tilted area. Why this round bottom flask is kept tilted? Just because it does not trickle back into the heated flask. Because if that water get mixed with the heated flask again, then the whole flask get easily broken. Sorry. So this water should not trickle back to the main setup to avoid its breaking. Now this gas ammonia is actually a moist gas because it's collected with water, so we have to make it dry. And as a drying agent, we are going to use one component, that is CaO, calcium oxide, quicklime. Yeah, this is the word quicklime we are using as a drying agent. And after drying, that ammonia gas will be passed to the next chamber. One more thing, calcium oxide, you are thinking might be, can't we use any other drying agent? The same problem, if you are going to use H2SO4 or P2O5 or calcium chloride as a drying agent, all these three components, then all these three can easily react with ammonia and they are giving a new compound. So we are not going to use this all other drying agent, and we have to use only calcium oxide, that is a quicklime. Now on a collection method, if we will focus here, I wrote something that ammonia and air, out of that, which one is heavier? This is wrong. Ammonia is lighter than the air. Yeah, ammonia is lighter than the air. So ammonia and air, amongst that, ammonia is lighter and air is heavier. If air is heavier, it remains settled down here and ammonia will be collected upward. Okay, so here I can use a word, ammonia is collected by keeping that air downward, so it is called as downward displacement of air. Yeah, this is the collection method. You have to remember, it is downward displacement of air. Through downward displacement of air, ammonia is collected on air. This is about the lab preparation. Now some give reason questions are there, that we can use different ammonium salt, actually ammonium chloride, ammonium sulfate, we can use alkali also, we can use CaOH twice or NaOH or KOH, but we cannot use ammonium nitrate or ammonium nitrite. Why it is so? Because ammonium nitrate or ammonium nitrite, on decomposition, it just releases a compound, like ammonium nitrate releases N2O. N2O is a laughing gas and water vapor. Here is nitrogen gas and water vapor. So in short, we are getting a different compound over here. Before having reaction with this alkali only, this ammonium nitrate or nitrite get itself decomposed into this component. So there is no chance of making this ammonia in this setup. So we cannot use N8 for NO3 or N8 for NO2 in the setup. Now, as we have discussed one method, in the same way, some another component we can use in the preparation. Like we have these two components, Mg3N2 and aluminium nitride. You know what is this? For making ammonia, we can use this sources also. Mg3N2 is a divalent metal nitride. Yeah, this is a name the following question can be asked. Divalent metal nitride, Mg2+. Yeah, that is divalent and nitride. This is aluminium nitride, that is trivalent. Yeah, this is trivalent aluminium nitride. So we can use this magnesium nitride and water in the same way. When they both react, they forms magnesium hydroxide and ammonia, or here aluminium hydroxide and ammonia. The reaction and the collection method, reaction might be little different, but collection method is totally same. See, this is a setup. Here magnesium nitride and water reacts together to form MgOH twice plus NH3. This NA3 will be passed through this delivery tube collecting here. Here we kept a drying agent, same what we have discussed, calcium oxide. It is passed through that and collected in the upward box, that is by downward displacement of air. Air remains down and ammonia will be collected up because vapor density of ammonia is less than air. So this is another method for making ammonia. Now this is the preparation of aqueous solution of ammonia. Aqueous solution of ammonia, might be you can recollect the same diagram I think we have seen in HCl chapter. Here the major thing is what, from one side the ammonia sources is actually passed. Here it is being passed to the funnel and water is there. When water is coming in contact with the rim of the funnel, definitely the same thing will be happened. Okay, the ammonia will be dissolved in water, and because of that in this funnel the pressure get reduced. As the pressure get reduced, in this area, and to maintain that pressure, water definitely rush into the funnel. Yeah, water will be definitely rush into the funnel. So it will leave a little bit gap, okay, when the water is passing. Now here back suction is not totally done. We can't say it's a total back suction. Why? Because water will remain little bit water as it is being passed into the funnel for a short time. It remains only up to that particular time when the new ammonia will be formed and it will be passed. So when new ammonia gas will be passed, till that gas will push that water again into the main solution, again into the main beaker. So that is a very less back suction, or might be I can say no back suction will be occurred. So that is the reason here. And one more thing you have to note, that is the solubility of ammonia in water is its maximum, highly soluble, so that water can be easily saturated with the ammonia gas. So the chances of back suction will be very less in this setup. And like HCl, how we have discussed, same way the ammonia gas will be dissolved in water, and later on it will be completely converted into a solution of ammonia, that is ammonium hydroxide. Moving to the next point is Haber's process. Haber's process is industrial preparation of ammonia. The scientist Haber had actually made a process of making ammonia at a very large scale, and in that he used nitrogen and hydrogen, these two gas, in a proportion of 1:3. In a proportion of 1:3, he used this component 1:3 by volume. Okay, now this nitrogen and hydrogen, what are the sources? So nitrogen source is nitrogen extracted from the liquid air, and hydrogen will be prepared from the Bosc process. Yeah, these are the sources of nitrogen and hydrogen. So from one side N2, and from another side H2 will be passed in 1:3 by volume. Now both the gases are being mixed into this compressor. This is compressor. In compressor, both the gases are well mixed, and it will be passed to the next chamber, that is catalytic chamber. So in this reaction, you have to remember, it is not easily occurred. That is a different component used for having a conversion of nitrogen hydrogen into ammonia. So over here, the first thing, we are going to use a catalyst named as Fe divided, that means finely divided iron we are going to use as a catalyst. Second, we are using molybdenum as a promoter. Either you can use molybdenum or you can use Al2O3. We can use any of the promoter. You know, promoter will be used to enhance or increase the ability of catalyst. So we are using finely divided iron for catalyst. Now, temperature we are going to put is 450 to 500 degrees Celsius. And the pressure we are going to keep is nearby or above 200 atm. Actually, in your book might be somewhere it is given 200 to 900 atm. You can write above 250 atm also, or you can write above 200 atm also. Okay, you can provide this specific pressure. Now, in this condition, in the catalytic chamber, nitrogen and hydrogen will mix to form ammonia and heat. If heat is being released, then definitely you can consider this process as exothermic. Now, this is the advantage. You know, this process is exothermic, that is the advantage. Why? This process is exothermic because of that the heat, once this reaction will start, the heat will be generated, and that heat only is required for maintaining a temperature that is 450 to 500 degree. That means once this reaction starts, okay, you have to put off or you have to switch it off the supply of gas or supply of fuel for providing heat, because later on, because of the exothermic reaction, the heat will be generated, and that heat only will maintain the temperature 450 to 500 degree. That means you don't have to burn more amount of fuel. That is the advantageous thing over here. Now, nitrogen and hydrogen will mix together, and later on ammonia will be formed that will come to this area. This is a cooling tower. So here I have kept cooling in and cooling out. Okay. For cooling we are using either cold water or ice or some other thing we can use. Now, strange but very unfortunate thing, in this total process, once the process will be done, nitrogen hydrogen can mix only up to 15%. Only 15% of nitrogen hydrogen of the total quantity will mix and form ammonia. That means in the remaining, in only 15% of ammonia will be formed. Then remaining of nitrogen and hydrogen, yeah, it remains in this chamber. In this cooling chamber, right now you can say three different gases are there. NH3, H2 and N2. All three gases are there. Now from that you have to separate ammonia. So for that, ammonia is to be recovered from the mixture of this gas by two different methods, and those method names are liquefaction and one is liquefaction and second is absorbing by water. Yeah, absorbing in water. You know what the, how these two methods are actually followed. Liquefaction means what? You have to liquefy the collected ammonia. Good thing is what? As you are providing lower temperature or somewhat higher pressure, then ammonia gets easily liquefied. But hydrogen and nitrogen remain as such. So ammonia liquefied easily, that will be collected either by liquefaction in the liquid form. So over here, through this route, you can easily collect liquid ammonia. Or else, the another route or another way is there, absorbing in water. Yeah, absorbing in water, in that NH3, as it is highly soluble in water, whereas N2 and H2 are almost negligible soluble in water or slightly soluble in water. So you can easily collect by dissolving ammonia in water also. In that case, you are getting the ammonia in the form of ammonium hydroxide. Okay, from that also it's possible to extract ammonia as a pure gas form later on. Or you can directly use ammonium hydroxide solution only. Now, the major problem is this, what to do with this remaining hydrogen and nitrogen. Because remaining hydrogen and nitrogen, if it is being wasted in this way, then this method is very costly and it's not that worth. So here one setup is made. See this direction. Through this direction, this unreacted H2 and N2 will be passed through this tube you by using this compressor, it is being recirculated in the main setup. That means it is being passed again into the main setup and it is being added again into the catalytic chamber. So again by recirculating this, remaining of the N2 and H2, we are at last getting this ammonia as a, as for percentage we can count then 98%. We are getting 98% of this components reacted and we are getting ammonia in this form. Previously, you know, it's only 15% and right now it's 98% of ammonia is collected. Okay, so that is a major good method over here. Something you have to be very careful in having this Haber's process. That is catalyst what we are using. Okay. And promoter what we are using, they can be easily poison means they can be easily affected by some impurities what is being added. You are thinking we have not added anything. Yeah, if we are taking N2 and H2 not in a pure form, if N2 and H2 are not pure, then with nitrogen or with hydrogen some of the unwanted gases are coming, and those gases names are hydrogen sulfide or carbon monoxide. These are unwanted gases. If these gases are being passed into the catalytic chamber, then that these components are easily affecting the finely divided iron. They are affecting Fe and they are reducing the efficiency of Fe to work for mixture of this N2 and H2 for making Na3. So we have to be very careful. We have to take a pure nitrogen and hydrogen for making this ammonia. Now we have to focus on the physical properties of ammonia. You know, ammonia color is colorless. Odor is strong and pungent choking smell. Yeah, it's a very characteristic smell. Taste wise, it's bitter because it's alkali. Alkalis are alkaline or alkaline taste. So or alkaline are quite bitter in taste. Physiological nature, non-poisonous. But if it is inhaled, affect the respiratory system and brings tears to eye. It is a powerful heart stimulant and may cause death when if it is inhaled in a large quantity. So it can be a component to create a harm to the heart if it is being inhaled in a very large quantity. Density definitely less than the lighter than the air. Nature wise it is alkaline by nature. Liquefaction done at 10 degrees Celsius, 6 atm pressure. It's not that important. Boiling, freezing point, both you don't have to remember. Solubility, it is highly soluble. Here see, it's a 702 volume. It's quite more than the HCl. So it is highly soluble in water. That's why it is not collected on water. This experiment might be, you know, I think we have done in HCl. Over there might be you have read it's a red fountain. But over here it's a blue fountain. Why it is so? Same setup, same thing is there. Because the experiment is also to check or to demonstrate the high solubility of ammonia in water only. See, here we kept red litmus solution. In this flask we have kept already ammonia gas. This is a jet tube. With this dropper we are going to put one or two drop of water in this. As the water is being passed, definitely the same thing will be happen. In that water, ammonia in high quantity, it will be dissolved. The pressure get reduced. And to maintain that pressure, the red litmus solution will move upward. As it will come at the top and coming in contact with the remaining ammonia, as it is basic by nature, it will turn the red litmus solution blue. And due to that, the fountain come out over here. The fountain come out over here, it's a blue color fountain. So as we can check with this, the nature of ammonia, that is, it is highly soluble in water. Here is one give reason question. The bottle of liquor ammonia, I think you know liquor ammonia fortis, yeah, it should be opened very carefully only after cooling it in ice or cold water. You know the reason is what? Because they are already with the high pressure inside the bottle, and when you are cooling them, the pressure is simply little bit, it drops. So when you are going to open it, can easily or suddenly it's flushing out from that bottle. So we have to take care of that. We have to allow that bottle to be properly we have to settle down that bottle properly. Okay, on higher cooling we cannot easily open it, because on that cooling the pressure will be flushing out and there might be a chance of having breaking also of the bottle. This is all about ammonia and the physical properties of ammonia. Thank you.